Have you had problems finding any matches with DNA? Do all of your close matches only share about 50 centimorgans or less with you? If so, you may suffer from the problem of small families. Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, and this is a segment of DNA. Be sure to subscribe to our channel and click on the bell if you'd like to be notified about upcoming episodes. Family sizes have varied a lot over history, but in the last 200 years, the trend has been to smaller and smaller family sizes. But when it comes to DNA and genealogy, how small is too small? The concept of using DNA in genealogy is that we share DNA with our relatives. But like I've said before, we don't share DNA with all of our relatives. Once you get out to third cousins and beyond, you share 50 centimorgans or less with these relatives. But not only that, you share DNA with less and less relatives the further out you go. I did a video about this, and you can check out a link in the description below to watch that video. The other difficulty in using DNA as a record is it takes two to tango. Your DNA by itself is worthless. It is only when others test and we can match your DNA with their DNA that DNA becomes valuable as a genealogical record. Now, as of 2019, only about 5% or less of the US population has had their DNA tested. Many people get discouraged with their DNA test because they're not finding matches that they can identify a common ancestor with. And this has caused some people to doubt the validity of using DNA as a genealogical tool. DNA is a record, and just like any other record, it has its advantages and its disadvantages. Mainly, DNA is a record of our relationships. But it doesn't contain information about every relationship. Now, just like with a birth certificate, you don't get upset because it doesn't tell you what your relationship with your Aunt Margie is. You wouldn't expect it to. That birth certificate doesn't serve that purpose. Same way with DNA. Once we understand what relationships we can find with DNA, and once we understand how those relationships occurred, then we can better use DNA to find relationships that we can identify a common ancestor with. Autosomal DNA can reliably match you with people out about 5 to 7 generations. Now, this doesn't mean that you're not going to find 8th, 9th, or 10th cousins. It just means that most of those finds are really going to be by pure luck. For instance, I've actually matched with a 9th cousin on 23andMe. But the reason why we were able to determine that we were 9th cousins is because both of us had extensive trees that we were able to see how we matched up, and I was clued in on the match because there was a last name in there that was common with some of the surnames that I already knew were in my family. Small families means that there's less people that you can match with. But how much less are we talking about? Let's make a table and show you. Down the side, you can see that we have the number of generations. This corresponds to siblings, first cousins, second cousins, third cousins, and so on. Now, the row across the top represents the average family size over those generations. Now, not every generation is going to have the same family size, but this is an average to give you an idea of how many people there are going to be that you possibly could match with. I am only looking at between 2 and 7 children on average. Now, many families had much more than 7 children. However, what we're really concerned with is the number of children that reached adulthood, and so they had the possibility of passing on their DNA to somebody else that you may match with. Let's see how much of a difference just a couple of children really matter over 7 generations. Starting with a family size of 2, that would mean that there are 2 siblings. Now, each one of these siblings had 2 children each, and so there were 4 first cousins. Now, each of those cousins also had 2 children apiece, and that means that there were 8 second cousins. This continues on until you have 128 sixth cousins. That may sound like a lot of people, but we need to compare it to another family size. So let's look at a family size of 3. Wow! More than 2,000 sixth cousins just by going from a family size of 2 to an average family size of 3. That is 17 times the number of relatives, which means it's going to be 17 times easier to identify somebody that you share a common ancestor with. All because the average family size increased by just one. So what about with 4 to 7 children? As you can see, the numbers begin to explode into the tens of thousands and even hundreds of thousands. Which means if you have a very large family size over the last 5 to 7 generations, your ability to identify cousins using DNA is hundreds and thousands of times easier than somebody who only had a family size of 2 over the last 7 generations. Now let's assume that you are down here at the 7th generation and you want to find a cousin that also is at the 7th generation. Well, your common ancestor would actually be at generation 0. They would be the parents of those siblings from generation 1. Now, we don't all share DNA with all of our relatives. In fact, the further we go, the less DNA we share. And so at the 5th, 6th, and 7th generation, we only share about 15%, about 5%, and about 1% of DNA. So really, only the last 3 generations, so generations 5, 6, and 7 of this, could have possibly tested, because DNA testing wasn't around before that. So the first thing we need to do is multiply each one of those generations by that 15%, 5%, 1%. But then remember, only about 5% of adults in the United States have actually had their DNA tested, so we need to multiply each one of those numbers by another 5%. That gives us this kind of numbers. You can see that for an average family size of 2, you actually will probably have 0 people that have had their DNA tested that you could match with at that 6th or 7th generation level. At a family size of 3, it's much better, because you can have up to 5 people that might have tested at each of those levels. Unfortunately, if you look at all of your matches, you might have thousands or tens of thousands of potential matches at that 6th and 7th generation level, and you're trying to find 5 specific ones in that. That's still a really difficult task. And this exemplifies the problem with small families. There's just not a lot of DNA all around to be able to match to. So finding new relationships through DNA is going to be difficult, but not always impossible. So how can you figure out whether you're closer to 2 or whether you're closer to 7 on the average family size scale? Most people don't know all of their relationships out to 7 generations. So let me show you a way that I estimate it just using 3 generations. We'll use my dad as a starting point and use this chart to help us out. In my dad's family, there were 8 siblings. So we're going to put an 8 in the children box. And in the next box, for the number of families that we're looking at, there was only 1 family. So we put the number 1. That averages out to 8 children per family, which is much greater than 7. So right now it's looking like there's going to be hundreds of thousands of people that I could potentially match with. But then we go down to the next generation. I want to look at each of those 8 siblings and see how many kids were in those families. So there's actually 28 of us cousins at that level. So that means in the first box, we're going to put 28 plus the 8 that we already found. That would be 36. And in the second box, we're going to put 8, because we've added 8 new families, plus that 1 family that we've already calculated, and that's going to give us 9. And you can see that the average family size is now only 4. Just in one generation, we've cut that family size in half. But 4 is still quite high, and it's in the tens of thousands, 6 cousins that we would be able to find. Now the last line is going to be all of my kids plus all of my cousins' kids. So all those cousins' families we're going to be adding in. Now I've added up all the cousins' children that I know of. And if I add it to the 36 that we already have, what I get is 90. Now that gives us an average of 2.43, which is a lot lower than that original 8 that we started with. One thing to keep in mind is I have about 6 to 10 cousins who are still at that age where they're having kids, or they're just barely married and they haven't had any kids yet. So that 90 number may increase. If we increase that number to 120, then the average family size on my dad's family will be about 3.24. Now, I ran this same calculation on my mother's side of the family, and she actually starts out, instead of with 8 siblings like my dad's family, there's only 2 siblings in her family, her and her sister. But even though it starts out small, because their kids and their grandkids had so many, they also have a family size just over 3.09. Then I get to my wife's. And my wife's father was an only child, and his father was an only child. So it's looking like their family may actually be a small family size. When I calculated her father's 3 generations of family size, it was 2.75. So it's still close to what these other family sizes are, but, you know, somewhat less. Then when I calculated her mom's family size, it was only 2.6. So it was the lowest of all of them. Now again, this is just an estimate based on the most recent 3 generations. If you happen to know more information about older generations, then you can always include that to get a better estimate of what the average family size is over 7 generations. So let's take a look at our table again, except instead of going from 2 to 7, let's actually look at 1.5 to 2.75. And we'll do that in 0.25 increments. Now you can see as we've decreased that number that the numbers of course go down, but what I want to point out is that even a 1/4 increment will multiply the number of 6 cousins by 2.5. So if you're comparing my wife's family, which is about 2.75 for an average family size, to my family, which is just over 3.0 for an average family size, most likely I'm going to find 2.5 times as many relatives through DNA as she is. And honestly, that's exactly what happened when we first tested. She actually found nobody for the first couple of years. There was really no matches that we could link up to find a common ancestor, whereas I was able to probably find about a dozen ancestors in the first couple of years. Now, in the last couple of years, with the explosion of DNA testing, it has been much better for everybody. My wife has been able to link up with several people as well as myself. And I think going forward, that's just going to increase as more and more people are tested. So if you're not finding a lot of matches, take a look at the pedigree chart that you do have and see if you suffer from the problem of small families. Unfortunately, there's no way around this. The best you can do is get as many of your relatives to test. So if you have any questions about small family sizes and how it's affecting your ability to find DNA relatives, put it in the comments below and we'll try to answer it for you. And if you like this video, make sure you give it a thumbs up and be sure to tell all your friends.